Today we shall start the alkenes topic. Alkenes means the organic compounds having at least one carbon-carbon double bond are called alkenes. Okay, so in this carbon-carbon double bond, the hybridization of the double bonded carbon atom is sp2, bond angle is 120 degrees, and the shape is planar. So these are having the planar shape, means all the four groups that are connected to the both of the double bonded carbon atom along with these two double bonded carbon atom lies on the same plane. If you take like this, they will be on the same plane. Hence we say that this is a planar shape, actually trigonal planar shape. Now let us try to see the stability of the alkenes. I just give a idea about the stability of the alkenes. More substituted alkene, more the substituted alkene, more will be the stable, more will be the stability. So let us see some of these different type of the alkenes. See, R2 C double bond CR2 means here these two carbon atoms are completely occupied by some other alkyl groups. So four substituents are, it is more stable than the alkene that is having the three substituents, one hydrogen and one alkyl group. Next one is two substituents. Next one is also two substituents but on different carbon atoms. Next one is mono substituent, and the last one is ethene molecule. So from this it is very clear that this is more stable, means it is less reactive. So reactivity order is opposite to this. So I'll write that one here. This is the, from this side to this side, stability decreases and reactivity increases. So regarding the reactivity, this is the most reactive one. So you can write down the compounds in opposite way if it comes to the reactivity. Now let us see how to prepare these alkenes. So first of all, there is a process of dehydration of alcohols. Methods to prepare the alkenes is dehydration of alcohols. So in alcohols, you take any alcohol, the alcohol that contains OH group and hydrogen on the adjacent carbon atoms loses one water molecule like this and develops a carbon-carbon double bond. So alcohol becomes finally alkene. Okay, so here there is a loss of water molecule. Then which reagents or catalysts are usually useful for the loss of water molecule, means removal of the water molecule from the alcohols and to create the alkenes? Generally acids. It may be H2SO4 you can take, or else you may take the H3PO4, or you may take the dehydrating agents like Al2O3, or you may take the P2O5, that means P4O10. So any of these reagents are very helpful, but among these reagents the most preferable reagent is H2SO4 and Al2O3. Let us try to see the reactions of these categories. And During the dehydration of the alcohols, one important thing happens that if you use any of these acids, H3PO4 or H2SO4, whatever the alkene is formed, that alkene may be the more substituted alkene and rearranged product. So, I will write here the dehydration of alcohols. The dehydration of alcohols in the presence of acid catalyst like H2SO4 or H3PO4 gives more substituted alkene, and this alkene may be a rearranged product. So, whether rearrangement is taking place or not, that depends on the type of the alcohol molecule we are going to select. Now, let us see what is the use of these two dehydrating agents like Al2O3 or P4O10. P2O5 can also exist as the P4O10. So, the dehydration of alcohols in the presence of dehydrating agents like Al2O3 or P4O10 gives less substituted product. Or else we may say that no rearrangement happens. So, first of all, let us see some of the example reactions so that you will come to know how to write down the product. So, I will take an example here. First example is, let us take a simple example like ethyl alcohol. So, ethyl alcohol, if undergoes dehydration in the presence of the concentrated sulfuric acid, there will be a loss of water molecule, one hydrogen from the CH3 and OH group from here. So, that we get the CH2 double bond CH2 plus there is a loss of water molecule. And second one, if you take concentrated sulfuric acid, cyclohexanol. So, here hydrogen is there, here also hydrogen is there. Both are same hydrogen, so that you can remove the water molecule from any of these two adjacent carbon atoms, so that you will get the cyclohexene. And next one is, let us try to take this particular molecule. So, OH group is here. Now, use the concentrated sulfuric acid. So, in this particular case, we may get the two different products, major and minor. Now, you can see here one hydrogen is there, here one hydrogen is there, here one hydrogen is there. And these all hydrogens are adjacent to this OH group. So, that if this particular one is removed, so that we get the product like this. Okay, and this hydrogen are same, that's why I am not writing one more product. Now, this particular hydrogen and this OH, if they are removed, so that the double bond will be developed over here. So, alkene is like this. But among these, between these two alkenes, in this particular alkene, you can see this particular double bonded carbon atom is having the two substituents. And here, this double bond carbon atom is having the one substituent this side, the other side hydrogen is there. So, both of these double bond carbon atoms are completely occupied by the three substituents, but in this particular case, this is having the two hydrogens, and here two substituents are there. So number of substituents are only two. So hence, as we said earlier, major means more substituted alkene is the major product. So that this is the major product, and this is the minor product. Okay. So now let us see other compounds also. This is the compound in which here one hydrogen is there, so there is a chance for the removal of water molecule here, and here also one hydrogen is there. So when it is subjected to the concentrated sulfuric acid, means we are using only acid catalyst, or else you can use even H3PO4 also. Both you cannot use, any one can be used. So in such cases, there is a chance for the loss of this particular water molecule, so that you will get this molecule like this. And if there is a loss of water molecule like this, then you will get the molecule like this. So between these two, this is the most substituted alkene. So this is called as the major product, this is called as the minor product. Let us take this some other more examples. You don't remember all these examples, remember only the concept. Let us take H3PO4 so that it becomes habit of using both of these reagents to you, concentrated H3PO4. So in this particular case, here hydrogen is there, here also hydrogen is there, both are same category. Okay, so you can remove the water molecule from this side, or you can remove the water molecule like this, but the products, you may get the cis product or trans product. Just see, the molecule will come like this. This is called as a trans product, because hydrogen is here and hydrogen is here, and there is a chance for the formation of this cis product also like this. This is trans and this is cis, but always trans is the major product and cis is the minor product, because trans stability is more. So now let us discuss the some other examples too. A given molecule is like this, and use the concentrated sulfuric acid and heat it. So in this case, there are chances for losing of this hydrogen, and chances of losing for this hydrogen, and chances of losing for this hydrogen. I'll notify this hydrogen as first hydrogen, this one as the second hydrogen, this one as the third hydrogen. Okay, so if first hydrogen is lost, then the product will be like this. This is the first hydrogen. And if the second hydrogen is removed, this is second hydrogen. And if the third hydrogen is removed, so this is the third hydrogen removed product. So among these products, the stability is more for this particular product, as this is the most substituted product. So this is the major product and this is the minor product. After this one, this is the next major product, and the minor product is this one, because this is a less substituted product. Now we are going to write down one more example. So in this example, the mechanism, actual mechanism, we shall discuss in the coming elimination reactions. So here there is a chance for loss of this particular water molecule like this, and here no hydrogen is there. Okay, so no hydrogen is not there, means here CH3, what we generally expect, this product is not possible, but actually it is possible. this is the one product. The other product is like this. Now we shall discuss, this is the major product. Let us discuss how this particular product is formed. Though we don't discuss the complete mechanism, only the mechanism required for this example we shall discuss. You just see here. This was discussed indirectly in the stability of the carbocations. So step one is this H2SO4 dissociates and gives H plus plus HSO4 minus ion. Second step is whatever the alcohol we have taken, this alcohol is having the two lone pair of electrons over the oxygen of the OH group. So when H plus ion approaches this OH group, it develops a coordinate covalent bond with the H plus ion and finally forms hydronium ion like species. Now this particular oxygen is carrying the positive charge which is unstable, so that it withdraws the electrons from the carbon and finally forms carbocation, stable secondary carbocation. Here there is a loss of water molecule. Now this particular one, here hydrogen is there. So if this hydrogen is lost, so that H plus ion will come out and there is a form, there is a chance for the formation of this particular product, whatever we have discussed. But in most of the cases what happens, here there is a shifting reaction takes place. Means methyl group will be shifted to this particular position. This is called as the 1,2 methyl shift. Why this methyl shift is taking place means whenever there is a chance for the groups to shift, ethyl group, methyl group, hydrogen, they always shift to the carbocation, adjacent carbocation, till they develop the stable carbocation. If this complete methyl group is shifted over to this particular carbocation, then we get the molecule like this. Since it is going to shift and develop the bond here, so that here positive charge will come. This is the tertiary carbocation. Tertiary carbocation is more stable than the secondary carbocation. Hence, this is formed. And once this is formed, whatever the water molecule, once this is formed, hydrogen from here undergo removal so that it develops the alkene like this. So this is called as the rearranged product. Rearranged product means this is not the rearranged product, this is the rearranged product. Why? Because there is a shifting of the one of the group took place and finally a product is formed which is not we expected. So that's why it is called as the rearranged product. So whenever acid catalysts are used, just remember that whenever acid catalysts are used, there is the attacking of the H plus ion over the alcohol group, so that carbocation will be formed. Once a carbocation is formed, a rearrangement takes place. So that's why I am going to write down here. In the presence of acid catalyst, in the presence of the acid catalyst, the intermediate is carbocation. You must remember that once a carbocation is formed and rearrangement takes place, hence rearrangement takes place. Okay. Now let us try to see the reactions, dehydration reactions with the Al2O3 molecule, alumina. Al2O3 is also called as the alumina. Now let us take the CH3CH2OH ethyl alcohol in the presence of the heated alumina Al2O3. I'll write down the name alumina. Okay, when alumina is heated, when alcohol is heated with the alumina, there is a loss of water molecule, no doubt that alkene will be formed. Let us take the second example. You just see this is the OH. Here CH3 groups are there. Tertiary butyl alcohol. When this tertiary butyl alcohol is used or heated with the alumina, there is a loss of water molecule from this particular hydrogen and OH, so that we get the alkene like this. Now I am going to write down the one more product, means similar example, the same example I am going to take here. This is the example what I am going to take, so that you will understand how the reactions are taking place. So this one, when subjected with the alumina Al2O3, heated alumina, the water molecule will be removed from the hydrogen OH group of the adjacent less substituted carbon atom. So this is the major product, not only major product, single product. But if the same compound is subjected with the concentrated H2SO4, as I said earlier, we are getting two products. Rearranged product is the most stable and major product, and other one is the minor product. This is the major product. Why? Because rearrangement took place. Here no rearrangement is taking place, because no carbocation is formed. Now let us see here, this is the molecule OH. So when you subject this one with the Al2O3 and heat it, the product what you are going to get here is, this is the one. But the same compound if used in the presence of the concentrated H2SO4 or H3PO4, here carbocation will be formed initially. Carbocation. This is the secondary carbocation. Then what happened? This methyl group will shift over here, which is called as the 1,2-methyl shift, ME shift. So 1,2-methyl shift, the moment it takes place, the molecule becomes like this. Here positive charge comes, and this hydrogen will be removed finally, and we are going to get the another product which is actually not expected. This is the product. Why we are getting this product? Because of rearrangement. Rearrangement is taking place and carbocation is formed. And in this case, if you use the Al2O3, less substituted product is going to form, no rearrangement takes place. This is the advantage of the Al2O3 also. So I will write down the important note here. Dehydration of alcohols. In the presence of Al2O3 or P4O10 gives no rearranged product. Already we have written no rearranged product due to no formation of, due to not no formation of carbocation. Since carbocation is not formed, hence no rearranged product is formed. And you must remember one more thing, that whenever you are dehydrating the alcohols in the presence of the sulfuric acid or H3PO4 and all these, you have to maintain the temperature at least 170 degrees centigrade, highest temperature for this dehydration of the alcohols. Okay. Now let's try to see another one, how to prepare the alkenes, that is by dehydrohalogenation. Dehydrohalogenation of alkyl halides. So alkyl halides, dehydrohalogenation, D means removal, hydrogen and halogen. So removal of the hydrogen along with the halogen is called the dehydrohalogenation. And in this dehydrohalogenation of the alkyl halides, we need certain reagents. First of all, I'll explain the concept. Just see here, hydrogen is here and halogen is here. So the hydrogen and halogen should present on the adjacent carbon atoms. So this is called like the alpha carbon, this is called like the beta carbon. So it is called like the beta elimination reaction. Both dehydration earlier reaction and this reaction are called the beta elimination reactions. We have already discussed this beta elimination reactions in our reaction mechanism. So when this dehydrohalogenating agents are subjected to the some reagents, dehydrohalogenating reagents, and they remove the hydrogen along with the halogen and finally produce alkene. The question here is, which reagents are useful for the dehydrohalogenation process? I am going to write down these reagents. You must remember only these reagents. Procedure is same, but reagents you have to remember. So those reagents are alcoholic KOH. Second one is ethoxide ion. And the third one is NaNH2 sodamide. And the fourth one is potassium tertiary butoxide. So these actually are using as the dehydrohalogenating agents. Let us see some of these reactions with each and every of these reagents. Let us use them as an example. So the first one is CH3, CH2, CH2, Cl. You must remember one more thing, that in any elimination reaction, except certain reactions like Al2O3, only major substituted alkene forms. In any elimination reaction, highly substituted alkene is formed because it is stable. So here hydrogen from this, out of these two hydrogens, one hydrogen and chlorine will be removed in the presence of the alcoholic KOH, so that we get the CH3, CH double bond, CH2. Whenever a particular molecule is removed, one pi bond will appear. And second reaction is CH3, CH, Cl and the CH3, and subject this one with the C2H5O-. Ethoxide ion just heated. Why we are using ethoxide ion means ethoxide ion is a base. These mechanisms which we are going to discuss in the coming chapters. So if you use this one, so that hydrogen along with the halogen will be removed, and again a pi bond will be developed between two carbon atoms, so propene molecule will be formed. Have you seen one thing, that here the one chloropropane, here we have two chloropropane, but products are same, because double bond has to be formed between only two carbon atoms. So whether chlorine is here or here, but product will be the same one. So now let us see the next one. Bromine. Now use the alcoholic KOH. Now the question arises, from where we have to remove the hydrogen? Here one hydrogen is there, here also one hydrogen is there. If you remove this one like this, the product will be, this is the product. And if you remove the hydrogen like this, and the product is this one. This is less substituted one, this is highly substituted one. So this is the major compound and this is the minor compound. Now let us use the NaNH2, this one. Okay. So in fourth example, let us take a different one. Chlorine is there and we are using the NaNH2. So here there are chances of losing the hydrogens from here, because both are adjacent carbon atoms. These two carbon atoms are same, so that you can remove either hydrogen from here or here, both are same. So that the products formed here are double bond will be formed by the loss of these two, hydrogen and halogen. Plus, if there is a chance of losing this one, so we get the another double bond like this. But this is a more substituted alkene, so that this is the major product and this is the minor product. And next, let us take one more molecule. Alcoholic OH. So again, similarly, unlike earlier case, hydrogen is one here, one hydrogen is here. So there are two chances of getting the molecules. One is like this, one is like this. But this is the major compound and this one is the minor compound. Now, the last product what I am going to write down here, sixth one, is you just use these molecules, bromine. Now, use the potassium tertiary butoxide. So that hydrogen will be removed only from here and the product is like this. And let us use some other examples also. Seventh one, why I have taken the potassium tertiary butoxide means, once the potassium tertiary butoxide is there, you must remember that less substituted alkene is the major product. So whenever potassium tertiary butoxide you are using, less substituted alkene is the major product. Reason is, this reagent is the bulky reagent, means a bigger reagent. Since it is so big, it cannot attack over this hydrogen to remove it on the more substituted alkyl carbon, so that it attacks over this particular hydrogen. I'll explain that mechanism, how actually things are going on. So a small concept I'll explain. If you observe all these are all basically bases. KOH gives OH minus M, C2H5O minus already is a base, NaNH gives NH2 minus, CH3 taken thrice CO minus. These are all bases. I'll write down their base component, then I'll explain the mechanism. Just to see here, alcoholic KOH, which is attacking reagent, means it gives K plus plus OH minus, which is a base, and NaNH2 dissociates into Na plus plus NH2 minus. This is a base, and anyhow C2H5O minus directly is a base, and next CH3 tertiary butoxide, O minus K plus dissociates and gives CH3 taken thrice CO minus plus K plus. This is also a base. So this base generally attacks over the hydrogen. How it will attack? Just to see, I'll explain the small mechanism only. You just take CH3, CH2, Br, a normal example. Ethyl bromide. So this ethyl bromide can also be written as CH2 hydrogen, CH2 and Br. Okay. So whenever the base, I am writing the base here. What is the nature of the base? You can see all these bases are the negative charged species. So the base usually attacks over the hydrogen, that is beta hydrogen. So this base attacks over the hydrogen. It takes this H plus ion. It takes H plus ion because the base is always having the negative charge. So once H plus ion is taken, then remaining electrons are present over this particular carbon only. So here this is CH2. CH2 negative charge. then it attacks over here, replaces the halogen part, so we get the alkene. A simple mechanism I had explained, not the complicated, actually mechanism is different. So here base basically abstract the proton. So in these cases you see OH- is a smaller base, NH2- is a smaller base, even ethoxide also to some extent is a smaller base. So these smaller bases, they can easily attack over the any type of the carbon atom. But this is the tertiary butoxide, is a larger base, size is bigger one, so that it cannot attack over the certain type of the more substituted alkene. See here, if this carbon atom is connected to the more, just imagine I'll write this one, just see CH3 and hydrogen is here, next CH bromine is here, next CH3 is like this, CH3 means I'll write CH2 and hydrogen. If you take this CH3 taken thrice, CO- K+, tertiary butoxide, this tertiary butoxide preferably attacks over this hydrogen and it will not attack over this particular hydrogen. Why? Because to attack over this particular hydrogen, it feels steric hindrance from these two groups. Hence, it cannot attack and to develop the double bond here. It preferably removes the hydrogen from the less substituted carbon atom, so the double bond will be formed between the carbon atoms, and finally we get the less substituted alkene. So whenever we are using tertiary butoxide, you always remember that less substituted alkene is going to be formed. Just 1 minute please. So like this, less substituted product is the major product once a tertiary butoxide is used. Now we can prepare the alkenes even by using the dehydrohalogenation of the vicinal dihalides, means side halides if they are present on the side carbon atoms, it is called the vicinal dihalides. Dehalogenation. So let's try to know what does it mean by vicinal dihalides. If two halogen atoms are present on adjacent carbon atoms, the compounds are called vicinal dihalides. Let us see here. Here X is there, here also X is there. So these X atoms may be present on the same side or they may be present on the opposite side. Whatever it may be, but they must and should present on the adjacent carbon atom. So they are called the vicinal dihalides. So these vicinal dihalides on reaction with zinc and copper couple in alcohol gives alkene, means zinc removes both of these halogens at a time. So we are going to write down some of these products. Example is, you just see CH2Br, CH2Br, and use the zinc copper couple in the presence of the alcohol, methyl alcohol or ethyl alcohol, just heat it. there is a loss of these two bromines. Bromines react with the zinc and form zinc bromide, and we get the ethene molecule and ZnBr2. Let us take another molecule. Heat it in the presence of the methyl alcohol or ethyl alcohol, whatever it may be. So there will be loss of these two halogens. And in these cases, we cannot expect the more substituted alkene and less substituted alkene. Here just we get the alkene where two halogen atoms are going to be removed. So double bond will be formed between the carbon atoms from where we are removing the two halogen atoms. Heat it. Again, there is a loss of two halogens and the product will be like this. Just see the halogens, means we are writing both are on the opposite side. So zinc, copper and heat it, alkene. So vicinal dihalides, when subject to the zinc copper couple, we get the alkene. Now similarly, let us see geminal dihalides. Dehalogenation of geminal dihalides. So geminal means here, that definition we have read on. If two halogen atoms are present on same carbon atom, such type of molecules are called geminal dihalides. Then how to convert these geminal dihalides into the alkenes? Same, zinc is the always the preferable compound which is expected to be removed, which is used for the removal of the two halogen atoms at a time. See, let us take a molecule. This is 1 plus 2 zinc plus 1 bromine and a bromine. So just heat it. So 1 zinc we can react with the 2 bromines. So 4 bromines are there, so that 2 zinc react with the 4 bromines and there is a double bond. Double bond will be formed between these two molecules. So we get the 2 butane. The same geminal dihalide, if I take and use alcoholic OH. What is the purpose of alcoholic OH? It is a dehydrohalogenating agent. It removes halogen along with the hydrogen. If you use the zinc, it removes only halogen, not the hydrogen. So in this particular case, what you are going to get is one of the hydrogen from here along with the bromine will be removed and you will get the vinyl bromide, means vinyl halide. If it is a chlorine, means vinyl halide. And from this, if you use alcoholic OH, no reaction takes place. Alcoholic OH cannot replace one more hydrogen and halogen. Why? Because these halogens are in resonance with the double bonded carbon atom and they almost form the, they get the double bond nature. CH double bond, bromine plus. So double bond nature will be there between the carbon and halogen atom. So it becomes difficult to break this bond. So alcoholic OH cannot remove one more hydrogen and halogen. Then which is preferable? That is sodamide. Sodamide is the strongest dehydrohalogenating agent. It even removes the halogen from the vinyl bromide. So one hydrogen is here, one bromine here. So they will be removed. Already double bond is there. Now triple bond is going to be formed. So we get the alkyne. So when geminal dihalides are undergo dehydrohalogenation in the presence of the alcoholic OH, vinyl bromide is the ultimate product. And if sodamide is used, acetylene means alkyne is the ultimate product. This is the important reaction. Okay. Now let us try to see how to get the alkenes from carboxylic acids. Electrolysis. Dicarboxylic acids. So, just like coal-based electrolysis process, in the coal-based electrolysis process, we have taken CH3CO- and K+, potassium ethoxide, so that when it undergo electrolysis process, two molecules in the same, the reaction will be like this. This was discussed in the reaction mechanism. Even I had sent you the video also, private video. You can check over there. So these two groups, they connect with each other and they develop the ethane molecule. Along with ethane molecule, many other products, esters and all these will be produced. This is normal coal-based electrolysis reaction. But you just see, if these two are already connected like this, CO- and K+, and CO- and K+. Now, if it is subjected to the electrolysis process, if there was no bond, a bond is developed. Now, already bond is there. Again, there is a breakage of this one. One more bond will be developed. So, what we'll expect? Double bond, alkene. And this is the carbon dioxide and remaining procedure is same. And these two will be released at the anode. KOH and water molecules at the cathode. So decarboxylation, this is simply called the decarboxylation. So decarboxylation of the dicarboxylic salts subject to the electrolysis gives the alkenes like this. Now let us take some of the examples of this particular method. So second example is, what happens if I take like this? So these all reactions will be very helpful in coming classes, where generally we don't discuss much reactions, we discuss the conversions. So these reactions will just convert, keep on converting to one product to the other product. So that's why I request you, just you go through these reactions perfectly. So this has to be removed completely, develop a double bond here. So I am writing only the products which are released at the anode. Cathode means KOH plus H2O. So these will be released at the cathode. So that, be careful. Now let's take one more compound. You can take even sodium also, not only potassium. So remove this particular area, develop the bond here, alkene. Now generally among the people, question arises, sir, what happens if the product compounds are like this? If there is already double bond, if only one compound is taken, remove this one, you will get the triple bond there, but it is unstable. Triple bond in cyclic compound is unstable because triple bonded carbons bond angle is 180 degrees. Here 180 degrees is not possible, so that's why these are unstable. That's why generally in reactions, two molecules will combine with each other like this. But if they say any possibility, that means possibility is there, but unstable product. So that we take one more product. So in reaction, they put a 2 here. So we just remove all these electrolysis. Connect these two cyclic groups. Double bond is there, double bond is there. So a new bond is going to form between these two like this. I did not write properly. Okay, I'll try to make it very properly. Yeah, just to see here. It looks good now. So this is the compound what actually we will get. Okay, this is about the electrolysis. Now let us see the preparation of alkenes from alkynes. Preparation of alkenes from alkynes. So alkynes means, you know, there is a triple bond between two carbon atoms. So to these alkynes, we must add one hydrogen in the presence of some catalyst. So that what happens, CH double bond CH will be formed. This is alkyne, this is alkene. Actually, there is a chance for the conversion of this double bond carbon atom to the single bond carbon atom in the presence of the catalyst, like this also possible. This is called as the alkane. Now, if any alkyne is directly converted to the alkane, then that is called the complete reduction. Complete reduction, or simply it is also called the complete hydrogenation. Why? Because we are removing all the 5 bonds. But alkyne to alkene, if it takes place, it is called the partial reduction, or else simply called the partial hydrogenation. So to do the partial hydrogenation, this is very important. Catalyst is so important. So now let us see what type of catalysts are very helpful. If you use nickel, platinum, palladium, then they directly take the alkynes to the alkanes. So that we must be very careful in selecting the catalyst. So I am going to write down the catalyst first here. Catalyst is nothing but the palladium we take. This palladium is adsorbed over the calcium carbonate, or sometimes they may give the barium sulfate plus quinoline. Quinoline and lead acid. Most of the people, they don't teach the lead acid, they just convert palladium, barium sulfate, quinoline. Only till here they say. But this entire combination of the catalyst is called the Lindlar's catalyst. Okay, then why we need quinoline, why all this? Simple thing is, one small concept I'll explain. Quinoline acts as a catalytic poison. So when palladium takes the hydrogen and carried out the only first step, after the first step, quinoline poisons the palladium, so that palladium will lose all of its activity, so that second reaction will not be carried out. So quinoline is used as a catalytic poison. So once only partial hydrogenation takes place. But one interesting thing here is, if you use the Lindlar's catalyst, this Lindlar's catalyst convert the alkyne plus H2 in the presence of the Lindlar's catalyst. Always write down like this: palladium, barium sulfate, quinoline, lead acid. But most of the textbooks now they are giving in entrance examinations calcium carbonate, because people are aware of the barium sulfate, but they are unaware about the calcium carbonate. So they are using the calcium carbonate now in entrance examination. So whenever alkyne is subject with the hydrogen in the presence of this Lindars catalyst, we always get the cis alkene. Means the hydrogens what they are going to add to the double bond, triple bond carbon atom, both of these hydrogens go and add from the same side. Hence this addition is called the syn addition. If any addition takes place, because we are adding no hydrogen completely, if any addition takes place from the same side, it is called like the syn addition. And if one hydrogen from this side, one hydrogen from that side, means it is called like the anti-addition. That is also there. That is called as the one more reagent is there. I'll explain that one also. Even you can convert the alkynes to the alkenes. Alkynes can also be converted to alkene by using sodium plus liquid ammonia. Sodium plus liquid ammonia. So this combination also converts the alkyne to the alkene. So if you take the alkyne plus add hydrogen and take the sodium plus liquid ammonia, we get the alkene. You know what type of alkene we are going to get? It is transalkene. This is trans. So here hydrogen is going to add from the both sides. Means this is called as the anti-addition. Anti-addition means if both sides addition reaction is taking place opposite from opposite sides, then it is called the anti-addition. Now I'll write down the one particular reaction so that it will clear all of your doubts. You just take this molecule PHC triple bond CPH and subject it to the two different reagents in two different reaction vessels. One is hydrogen, palladium, barium sulfate, quinoline, and a lead state, CH3COO taken twice lead. And second one is sodium liquid ammonia. So this gives cis alkene, means like this pH and pH, hydrogen and hydrogen, cis compound. And this one gives trans alkene, hydrogen, hydrogen, pH, pH. This is called the trans alkene. So this is the use of these both of these reagents. These are all. So hope you understood. Tomorrow we shall discuss the rest of the concepts, and I am going to upload this video. I will share this video separately to your email ID. You can revise these concepts whenever you want, so that you don't bother about that. If you do not understand any of these concepts, you can ask me later. And do not forget to share, subscribe our channels. Thank you one and all for joining today's session.